الناس لست قلدا. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My name is Abdul Razak Ingutia, and this is the An-Nasheed Show. We're so happy to be on the Ramadan, and this is the fifth day of the month of Ramadan. How do you feel about being in the Saum?
I feel so happy, Brother Abdul Razak, because it is the middle of the 10 days of Mercy, and also it is the day that we mostly, as Muslims, we're fasting. We come closer to Allah, we repent our sin, we ask for tawbah. And I'm feeling so good about this.
I'm also feeling good about the Ramadan. Actually, I want to pose this very interesting fact to the viewers about the month of Ramadan. Did you know that the word Ramadan comes from the Arabic word which means the sun-baked ground or parched thirst? That was just for you to get to know and to have a benefit about it. We also have a sheikh here who's going to discuss with us the 10 of Rahmah. Sorry, I'm calling you Rahmah. So this is Sheikh Hassan Kinyomari. He's a professor from the University of Nairobi, and he's here to discuss with us a few matters. Yeah.
Welcome to the show, Sheikh.
Thank you so much. And there's no problem with you calling her Rahma. any lady in this world can be Rahma, because Rahma means mercy of God, and every lady in this world is a mercy of God.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
How about if they? Yeah. So I think from today onwards, I'll be calling you Rahma.
No problem. But anyway, my name is Fatma Yaqub, and we're so happy to have you here with
Thank
us,
you so much.
Ramadan Kareem.
Thank you.
Okay, Brother Abdul Razak, as we know that Ramadan is divided into three different categories. Mm-hmm. We have the first 10 days, which is called the 10 days of mercy, and then we have the second 10 days, which is the 10 days of forgiveness, and also the third day, which is the day that is freedom from hellfire. Mm-hmm. So today we're mainly going to talk about the first 10 days of mercy. So how should Muslim go about it? How we should carry ourselves when we're fasting the 10 days of mercy, and the rewards which we're going to get during these 10 days of mercy. And today we have our Sheikh here who's going to expound more on that.
I just have one question I would like to pose for you.
Yes.
What are the benefits of the 10 days of Rahmah in the month of Ramadan?
Yes, the first is that these 10 days fall in the Islamic calendar, which is the ninth month of Islamic calendar, as you have said. Mm-hmm. And when you look at it, you realize that Ramadan is the fourth pillar among the five pillars of Islam. Mm-hmm. And in these 10 days, a Muslim is supposed to try his level best to be as merciful as possible to human beings, because it's the 10th of Mercy. Mm-hmm. And Alhamdulillah, today is the first Juma, and we are in the middle of the 10 days. And in these 10 days, Abdul Qadir Jilani, mm-hmm. one of the most prominent Muslim scholars and awliya, was born in either first or second of Ramadan. Uh-huh. And Fatima al-Zahra, the daughter of Prophet Muhammad, died on Ramadan around 4th or 3rd of Ramadan. Uh-huh. So it's a very important month, and these are very important days. So a Muslim should try to understand and liberate the two. Mm-hmm. Remember, Abdul Qadir Jilani was the head of the awliyas of Allah, and Fatima al-Zahra is and will remain to be the boss of all women in paradise.
And as it is the first 10 days of Ramadan, which are the 10 of Rahmah, where we seek mercy from the Almighty Allah.
Yes.
And we do so many acts of dhikr. Not only are we supposed to have mercy among our friends and other people, but we're also supposed to ask for mercy from the Almighty Allah.
That's
also
right.
Understand we should also go ahead and seek to better our relations with
That's
other
very true.
People.
That's very
yeah,
true.
And I think it's one of other benefits that are notable about the month, these
yeah.
10 days of
In the first 10 days of Ramadan, number one, these are one of the most difficult days for even some of us. These are the days your body is not used to not eating, so mm-hmm. realize some of us, the lips are very dry. The stomach has problems.
They walk around feeling, looking like weaklings.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So now these are the 10 days which you are supposed to train yourself to be as steadfast, as principled as possible.
Uh-huh.
Because if you lose the 10 days, then you lose the others. And one of the things also one is supposed to do is to make sure that they attend Taraweeh.
Mm-hmm.
mm-hmm. from the beginning to the end. Uh-huh. The problem with the youth, especially the youth, we call upon the youth. You know, the youth are the ones who are supposed to be healthy, strong, but realize that the youth are the ones who pray, and then in the middle of that way, they run leave. Away.
Yeah.
So you wonder, where are they going? I know where they are going. They are going outside. Uh-huh. Some of them, unfortunately, also take some gut a little bit.
Exactly.
How do you take gut in Ramadan? Uh-huh. I always tell the youth, if you take gut in Ramadan, I'm so sure 80% you don't fast. Mm-hmm. Because what I hear from my friends who chew, because I have many friends who chew, they tell me, Sheikh Bana, nanywa maji karibu lita tano.
But like here, I'm sorry to interrupt you.
Yes.
But in the Quran, they say that eating cut or bairungi is not haram. So I don't see any problem.
Who says it's not haram?
It's not haram. And
but
it has
some bad effects.
It has bad effects, okay. But I don't think okay. it's...
Okay, my sister, let's not dwell into that too much. Mm-hmm. But you see, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, Kullu muskirin haram. Everything which intoxicates you is haram.
Mm-hmm.
I have a friend actually who confessed to me, you know, my sheikh, people come to me.
Uh-huh.
I asked him, how did you quit from this thing? Because he could chew daily. He told me one day he was somewhere at night and there was bonfire.
Mm-hmm.
So what he realized is that fire entered his own now heel. Mm-hmm. The shoe had already burnt, and he was asking people, where is this heat coming from? And he had already eaten his own shoe.
He was so intoxicated.
Is that
to
not
a point
intoxication?
It is.
So if it isn't intoxication, mm-hmm. then it's haram. Let me explain. I know what you want to go to. Mm-hmm. There are some scholars who take a gut. There are some.
Mm-hmm.
But they take only very few, like only three. They call them
the
branches, yes.
Yeah.
Three branches or four or five to keep them awake the entire night. That one is not
so
haram.
So you want to say if you take little of it, it's okay, but not much.
If you take little of it, it's okay. But if you take too much, it's haram.
Uh-huh.
Ah.
Yes.
So it's the same like smoking cigarettes?
Same as smoking cigarettes. But you see, cigarette has more of many complications than gut.
I think I think we might also summarize it this way.
Yes.
And you might correct me if I'm wrong.
Yes.
Where it said, I think it's in the Quran where it says, you're not, it's haram to harm someone else, and it is also haram to harm yourself.
That's true.
So anything that harms you, definitely, even if it's not been mentioned in the Quran, in the mirah haram, like, if it's not been mentioned in the Quran, but still, as long as it harms you, then it's haram.
Yeah.
Let's. I think we should also carry on with a few aspects of
yes,
the...
Yes, before you proceed to that, actually, what you have mentioned in Al-Mira Haram, in fact, the Mira mentioned in that word, you know, I'm a lecturer of Arabic language at the university, Machakos University, Catholic University at the rest.
Yeah.
Mira there means debates which are aimed at conflict.
Mm-hmm.
Any debate you enter into and you aim at having conflict with someone, it's called mira.
Uh-huh.
So when you hear mira in Arabic,
so it does not mean the heart.
It doesn't
itself.
Mean because I was in Malindi one time and one sheikh talked about wallahi, even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called this mira, and then he mentioned that one.
Yeah.
And I live for almost 4 years. I believe mira, that one in Quran, that word means mira.
Uh-huh.
It doesn't mean Quran. It means the debate which leads to conflict. Yes, we can
so
move forward.
So sheikh, to bring you back to the topic.
Yes.
So why was the first 10 days called the Day of Mercy?
They are called the days of mercy because we are told by Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, that on the first night, which is the most important actually, there are three or two most important nights in Ramadan. One is Laylatul Qadr.
Uh-huh.
The second one is the first one.
First night?
Yes, we call it Laylatul Nadra, meaning the night which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks upon all human beings in the world, asking them, who needs my mercy? I give it to him.
Oh.
So that's why now, if you begin from that day till the end, now you become among the best people who have mercy of Allah. Let me ask you, my brother, what do you need in this world if you get mercy of Allah? Do you need anything else?
Well, I think if you get the mercy of Allah, you don't need anything.
Don't need anything else.
you have mercy from the creator of everything course, that exists.
For you to get the mercy of Allah, it's said that you have to be merciful too.
That's very true.
So I have
true.
A question for you.
Yes.
So Allah says that for him to be merciful to you, you should be open and willing to forgive other people who
That's
are
very
you.
True.
So when we are fasting this holy month of Ramadan, we have our Muslim brothers and sisters who are not talking.
Yes.
So what can you say about these people who maybe they refuse to forgive each other? Is their fast still valid?
Speaking the truth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahimuna, Yarhamuhumur Rahman. Those who are merciful in this world, Allah will be merciful upon them in the day of judgment and also in this world.
Uh-huh.
And when we're talking about people who don't forgive others, they are those people. Forgiveness belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Mm-hmm.
And the moment you forgive someone, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives you more, even 100 times of what you have forgiven that person.
Uh-huh.
So it's upon each and every person to forgive each other. Any ibadah done by any Muslim who does not, who has a quarrel with a brother or a sister who is a Muslim, and they have not forgiven each other, their ibadahs are not accepted. Not only some, even salah, even hajj.
So it means that they would have gotten the entire 10 days, and including even the entire Ramadan, for them it will be a waste of time.
It's a waste of time.
Because they've not forgiven each other.
It's a waste of time.
Don't you think that is so unfair, because maybe the other party want to solve the issue, but the other one doesn't want to?
If you see, if there's a party, the one party who wishes to forgive and the other one, or wishes to be forgiven, seeks forgiveness and the other one doesn't forgive, then it is allowed in Islam. Because in Islam we say that innamal a'malu
binniyat.
Every action is upon intention.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And that's why even in Ramadan, one of the things you must do on daily basis, at night, you must come up with intention to fast tomorrow. And that's why many sheikhs in the mosque, they say, Nawaitu, so magadin, anada'i, miyawmi, shar Ramadan, harisana fardana alayna, imanan wahtisaban, lillahi al-kareem, Allah, walhamdulillah, meaning so that the viewers can understand that I intend to fast tomorrow in the month of Ramadan because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you're fasting because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you must forgive the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you go to seek forgiveness from a friend or a brother,
and he
and he refuses, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have already finished your part.
Okay.
Now it remains with the other person. So your ibadat are accepted, but ibadat are not accepted.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And I've also come across some instances where dhikr is really emphasized in the first 10 days of the month of Ramadan.
That's
what would be
true.
The relevance of that?
Aisha, radiallahu anha, the wife to the Prophet Muhammad, is upon him. When the Prophet was, you know, on the 29th of Shaban, before Ramadan, the Prophet called the Sahabas and he gave them a very long khutbah, which began by saying that, Ayyuhan nas, kad adhallakum sha'un azimun. Shahrun, in fact, it is that hadith where the hadith of awalu rahma wa awsat mafiru akhnu nanar, that its beginning is mercy. Its middle is forgiveness, and the third one is saving from hellfire. It is in that hadith. It's a long hadith. And they asked him, Prophet Muhammad, you're talking of something very great. What do we do if you want to get the blessings of this month? He told them, every time you have to seek forgiveness of Allah, then you have to ask mercy of Allah. And that's why many Muslims in the world, you hear them saying, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa astaghfirullah, nas'aluka al-jannata wa na'udhu bika min an-nar. That is the dua which a Muslim should continue doing on every basis. So my sister Fatma, if you don't remember it, you have to memorize it from now. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. I mean, I wish that there's no one to be worshipped but Allah. Nastaghfirullah. We ask Allah forgiveness. Nas'aluka al-jannah. We are asking paradise from you, Allah. Wa na'udhu bika min an-nar. And we seek refuge
from
hellfire, from you, Allah. So you see that dua comprises all the three tens.
But we have some people that they say this decree every time.
Yes.
They utter it with their tongue, they feel it with their heart, but they don't put it in deeds. Because I've seen most people, they do that.
You see, Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Holy Quran, ma farratna fil kitabi min shay. We have not left anything, but it is in the Holy Quran. Allah asks us, believers, ya ayyuha alladhina amanu lima taquluna ma la taf'alun, kabura maktan inda Allah an taqulu ma la taf'alun. Oh, you believe, why are you saying what you are not doing? Most important in this world is not talks, It is actions. Actions are stronger than our words. So let all Muslims live by what they always keep on saying. Yes.
There is this important aspect I'd like us to bring across. For the sake of viewers who are not Muslims and they're watching this show and they would really like to understand what exactly is the Ramadan, what would you tell them is the Ramadan and why do we fast for 30 or 29 days and not 40 or less than 30 days?
Okay, first we begin by the verse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Baqarah or the chapter of Cow, verse 183. Where Allah tells us that يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Oh, you believe. Allah has prescribed to you fast, as it was prescribed to those who are before you, who are before us.
Well, predecessors, Isa alayhi salam.
Isa fasts for 40 days. And you see, for him, he fasts, when we talk of Isa, we are talking of Jesus, son of Mary.
Yeah.
He fasts for 40 days, continuous.
Without eating anything.
Without eating anything or taking anything. 40 days.
Total dry fast.
Yes, okay. Isa. Then the other one was Idris, Enoch. They call him Enoch. He used to fast a day and quit a day. Noah the same. He used to fast a day and quit a day. So you see, for Isa, he fasts for 40 days. For Noah and Enoch, they fast for the entire year. So it means 365 divided by two.
Yeah.
We Muslims, we are told to fast 1 month because it's one. We fast 1 month because it is mentioned in the Holy Quran, Shahru Ramadan. That is the reason why we fast for 30 days. Because Allah mentioned it, Shahru
Ramadan.
The month of Ramadan.
Nothing more, nothing less.
Nothing more, nothing else. Then why do you now, why does it mean you introduced it as the month where there was?
The month where it's the dry ground.
Yes.
Yeah.
The reason is the first time Ramadan was being prescribed to Muslims, it was very hot
and very dry.
That's why the month got the name Ramadan and it has continued up to date. And that's why even Hajj, the month which people started going for Hajj was called Dhul Hijjah or Dhul Hajj. That's
why
the
name
remains up to date. So that's one of the reasons. The other reason is that Ramadan is called Ramadan because it keeps you far from hellfire. And we believe hellfire is very,
very hot.
That's why it was called Ramadan, meaning that a month which keeps you far from the hellfire.
Okay.
Yes.
A few misconceptions that we were discussing a bit earlier about people saying that some things break the fast while they do not break the fast. Well, I'd like us to clarify this part because it's really interesting. Some people would say, oh, you cannot test food. For ladies, if you have makeup, it will ruin your fast.
Like my sister.
Yeah. Actually, she told me specifically not to mention lipstick.
Yeah.
No, you know, I saw this article. It was by a different sheikh. I don't remember who. He said, there are some things that people think break the fast, but it doesn't. Things like makeup, swimming, brushing your teeth. You know, it went to an extent that I think Muslims, my fellow Muslims are making Islam to sound so hard and difficult because they say when you're fasting you're not supposed to shower, when you're fasting you're not supposed to brush your teeth. So is this really true?
No, let me explain. The three most important things which a Muslim must understand are things to do, especially two things to do with the mouth, anything which goes through the mouth to the stomach. So it means water, soda, food, anything which goes through the mouth to the stomach, that nullifies your fasting, the first one. The second one is any action by our private parts, meaning sex, just to be clear. So those two nullify your soul completely. Now, when you come to issue like cigarette, it's also haram. Because cigarette, you take it through the mouth, it goes through the system, and many times that's where you see some people also bringing out from
the nose.
So that is haram. It nullifies your fast. Now, these ones, the three I've mentioned, eating and drinking and alcohol and water and the rest, if you use them, your soul is nullified for that day. So that you don't cut me short in this one.
Okay.
But if you have sex during the day of Ramadan, and I mean from today we are fasting from 5:13 up to 6:34. If between 5:13 up to 6:34, between that time you have sex with anyone, with your wife or anything, your fast is nullified for that day,
and you have a
and sin. You'll have to pay 60 continuous days. This is very important to the youth, because I was in a forum somewhere, I don't mention the forum, and many youth, we had almost 500 participants, and many youth were asking many questions about this issue. I've told them, please stop, run away from sex during Ramadan, even if it's your wife, even if it's anyone, because if you do it, you'll fight. Quran says, shahraini mutatabi'aini. You'll fast six for 60 consecutive days. So if you fast from the first day to the 59th day, then the 60th day you become sick. When you are okay, you begin from one again.
Up to 60.
Yes. So it means that Allah wants you to keep off sex.
But this sex is a lot for married couple after breaking your fast.
After breaking the fast at night, Allah tells us that uhilla lakum laylata siyami rafathu ila nisaikum. You are allowed at the night of Ramadan, rafathu ila nisaikum, entering, mingling with your wives. Hunna libasu lakum wa antum libasu lahunna. They are your clothes and you are our clothes. That's why, in fact, sometimes it's good for the young ones to sleep naked if possible. So they are close to each other. That's what Quran says. It's very important.
Yeah. Yes. So I have this question. They say that married couple, they're allowed to kiss and to hug.
During Ramadan?
Yeah. I read it somewhere in a book.
Let me explain. During the Prophet Muhammad's time, a young man came. And he asked the Prophet Muhammad upon him, can I kiss my wife? The Prophet said, no.
An older man, like me or him. Yeah.
And then an old man came after like 3 hours.
He was not the same question.
He asked the same question. He was told, you can kiss.
And
then after some time, the scholars, the Sahabas, companions asked the Prophet, why did you allow that young
exactly.
the old man, but the young man you didn't allow? The problem is, my sister, surely speaking, us, our bloods are hot. So if I go and kiss a lady, even if I'm fasting, there are many things in the body which will start now waking up.
And you will allow yourself, yeah.
But them there, even if he kiss even the entire night, he'll do nothing. So that is the reason. You know, Islam is about logic sometimes, and Islam is based on, Islam is a way of life. And that's why for me and you, my sister, never kiss your husband, even if I should not kiss my wife when I'm fasting.
What about hugging?
Hugging is allowed, because hugging is a way of like greetings. In Islam, you know, hugging in Islam is part of greeting. And someone asked me somewhere, why are you talking of hugging being part of Islam but not kissing? Kissing has its own connotation, which is known in many situations. Even if you say that, no, you know, we kiss, that is not part of Islam. And I was telling people, it's not part of Islam, kissing an unmahram, meaning kissing someone, or you can kiss your wife, you can kiss your mother, you can kiss your sister, you can kiss your aunt, but you cannot go kissing girls at work or boys saying that, no, this is not. It's not allowed. Ramadan and out of Ramadan.
But now, you can kiss your husband, is allowed.
Of course, but not when you're fasting.
Now,
because you make him go to work having problems.
Exactly.
Even the trousers will be exposing us other things.
Now, briefly, because it's a very interesting discussion, but unfortunately our time is running out.
Yes.
I'd like us to just, you know, the three of us, very, very fast to explain these things that do not ruin the this fast, because some people think that some things ruin the fast. Perhaps you can just list them as we finalize our discussion.
So what I've said there, I've already mentioned eating, drinking,
things that will not break your fast.
So I want now to explain things we don't nullify fast. One of them is like applying lipstick. It doesn't nullify, because the lipstick doesn't go in unless sometimes you just sit and manage it. The other thing which doesn't nullify fast is if someone is cooking, they're allowed to taste. As long as they make sure
they don't swallow,
they'll spit it out. Another thing which doesn't nullify fast is swallowing your own
saliva.
And this is what I want to talk to many people. You see, there are some Muslim brothers or sisters, every time you see them
spitting,
and you ask, what's the problem? Say, I don't want to nullify. No, my brother, my sister, swallow your own saliva. It is healthy to you, and it is allowed to do it, as long as you don't, what scholars say, don't take it out.
And
you know, there are also people who like playing with their saliva. As soon as it comes out of their lips, now you cannot take it in. And why should you do that?
So actually also, unhygienic.
And also injection do not nullify swarm. Mm-hmm. Injection doesn't nullify swarm. If you go for an injection, as long as it's not food injection, it doesn't nullify swarm. Another thing that doesn't nullify swarm is swimming. But when you are swimming, you must make sure that water doesn't go through your mouth. Because the people will go, and then they'll go, they call chomo. Mm-hmm. By the time they are down there, they take like 2 liters or 1 liter of water, then they come up. Now that will not nullify your swarm. If you know you swim like me, and you make sure that your head will always be up and you don't take water, your swimming is allowed, that doesn't nullify the swarm. Another thing is if blood comes out of your body, doesn't nullify your swarm. But doing hijama, cupping nullifies swarm. And the reason why Prophet Muhammad prohibited cupping during Ramadan is because it takes a lot of blood from you. It makes you weak. Mm-hmm. And Allah will never want to see anyone weakening themselves.
And also, just to add one more point on what does not break the psalm, even sleeping does not break the psalm.
Doesn't. Even bathing doesn't.
Doesn't. Even brushing your teeth
even
doesn't
brushing
break the psalm.
But what also you should do, there are also some Muslims, as soon as it is Ramadan, they buy a
miswak.
They put it here. Every time you see them,
The
Prophet Muhammad told us that la halufu fa miswa'in, that smell of our mouth when we are fasting.
It's like
khayrun atyabu indallahi min rihil misk aw kama qala. It's better to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala and more sweeter to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala than the fragrance of musk.
Okay, so actually that is really enlightening. I think I've gotten a point or two, and I believe that you also can do that.
So I don't think I have problem with my makeup anymore.
No, you don't.
Yeah.
Thank you for clarification.
Gladly, so you can apply so much lipstick, right? Well, it's a relief for you. Now, thank you very much for discussing these points with us, and I hope it's been of very great benefit to the viewers as much as it has benefited us. Now, right now, we are going to go for a very, very brief break, and then we come back. We will have a few nasheeds for the Ramadan just to give you all a little bit of a uplifting message and to remind each other what the Ramadan is all about and what it means to us as Muslims in very much significance. So do not go away. Just wait and stay tuned until we come back.